Thank you. amazing. It was very touching. Just the Spirit was in here. That's how I knew. The Holy Spirit was here. And then the next day I had somebody say to me, hey, I had somebody go to your church, and they said that there was some people dancing and waving flags, and it was just the weirdest stuff they ever saw, and they never went back. And I kind of took offense to it, you know? But then I remembered, I used to be that way. I used to think there's a certain way to do things, that there's this box that we're put in as to how we worship and how we dress, how we talk, how we act. And in Matthew 15:9, Jesus says, they pretend to worship me, but their worship is nothing more than the empty traditions of men. Right? But when the Spirit comes upon you, y'all, you worship him how he wants you to worship him.
Darkest day in history. anxiety, depression, suicide, pain, unbelief, fear of letting it go. And I'm working on that one. There's something. We all have a something. And He is mighty to save you. I can't recall that scripture off the top of my head, but anything that raises itself above the mighty name of Jesus is coming down. Anything that would dare. Because in reality, it's not above Jesus. It's not stronger than Jesus. Because He defeated death, hell, and the grave. Savior, He can. the marker. God, today it's different. We're serious about your love because it changes everything. He first loved us.
Thank you.
things in you by reading, by learning, by hearing, God, by preparing our hearts to be just more in love with you, to leave this building and be more like you, Lord. We praise you with our lives, God. We praise you in our attitudes. We praise you in just when things don't go the way we want them to, God. We're praising you. We're worshiping you, God. We keep that attitude as we go forth, Lord. Let worship change us. Let the word change us, Lord. Thank you for church. Thank you that you made a body to help one another, Father. You're so cool. We got a cool God. Oh, thank you for joining this house, Lord.
Stuff that already, all right. So we're bring anything back. I mean, there's stuff already going on, okay? We're just going to integrate into what the Holy Spirit is already doing, and we do not want to interrupt any of that. And so we're going to ask the Holy Spirit what it looks like. Not only for us, but for New Day, and what it looks like for all of us moving forward. So that's the heart behind it. So spiritually, that means we have to lay down some stuff. Like, you know, for Danielle and I, growing up as musicians and you know, being, you know, all about singing and parts and musicianship and all this. I was in a high school that had a high school choir that we represented North America in an international competition, okay? So musicianship was way high. So I was programmed, not that there was anything wrong with that. It's just when we enter into the presence of God, I was kind of bringing some of that in. And to see, like, man, Holy Spirit is saying, man, it doesn't matter if you miss notes. It doesn't matter if you get all this perfect. And he goes, I just want you to worship me. That was a transition for both of us. And man, we are just, I'm just elated to see the growth because there's been space that we step back. And I know for some, it's much more comfortable to stay the same. You like seeing our family, you like hearing our family, and our family will be back up here intermittently at times, okay? We'll be worshiping together again, but it's not going to be the same. Why? Because it can't stay the same. Because it was burning all of us out to go, I know you really like this, all right, let's go do this again. And the Holy Spirit will show up, and it's good. First Easter. And then we needed the rest. So we're coming back in, pacing ourselves. Anybody who's ever been a marathon runner, and no, I have not been one, in case anybody was wondering. But I hear that if you just gas yourself out the first 2 miles, you just aren't going to make it, right? You got to pace yourself. So it's long distance, and we are building the body of Christ, not spiritually, spiritually fat enjoyment. I mean, it feels nice. If I eat ice cream every day, it's not good for Paul, okay? Tastes good, great, you know, it really is, but it's not good for. The long term is the body of Christ moving together. So there is going to be a calling out and a calling up that the Holy Spirit is already doing. And we just want to integrate into that. So that's spiritually what's going on. Did you have anything to add to that?
Okay, so for me spiritually, it's been a deprogramming, like Paul was saying, most definitely. I grew up in the church. I grew up as a minister's kid and preacher's kid. And so we were at church behind the scenes 7 days a week, and we were at church any time the doors were open. And in the sect that I grew up in, that meant Sunday morning, Sunday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night, Friday night, Saturday work day, back to Sunday. So this has been my life. And I also watched several churches that revolved around the pastor. The pastor was the one that held it together. If the pastor left, nobody knew what to do. And that has never been our heart. God blew up our box several years ago. And we never wanted it to be about one family or one person or one couple. It's a very natural thing for the American culture to do so. It just is what it is. And so we very, very much took on that role feverishly, just wanting to fill the holes because we could.
And so it tends to not really leave a comfortable freedom for all of us that are attending, for you to be able to use your gifts or feel comfortable to say, hey, can I help in this area? But then we don't want to go begging people to say, hey, could you come along with us? You know? So, we worked hard on what Paul was saying. And I am very grateful that y'all are willing to give us the break. Not every church is willing to do that. To take a sabbatical means to rest. We had a few rumors passing around about our sabbatical, meant that we were leaving, but it's been all kinds of. But my favorite one was that we were turning Jewish. Because evidently the root word of sabbatical is Sabbath. So we were going to start observing the Sabbath. That was my favorite. Yeah. Well, rest assured, we are not turning Jewish. Okay. We are just taking a rest. And there's a lot of healing that I need as a minister's kid, preacher's kid, minister's wife. Being in the church, it's very hard. Getting attached to people and invested in lives and then no longer being in those lives for a variety of reasons. But I have to stay. And that's a lot of emotional healing. So I have a lot of healing to do, honestly. That said, one of our goals as ministers is to always be bivocational. We've never, ever, ever wanted to be reliant upon the church to support us as a family. Because why? We need to work too, just like anybody else. We need to be able to live life just like everybody else. We're no different. We can still walk in our calling, just like you. So these past few years where we've had to be supported just because of the elevation and different varieties of reasons, we are not enjoying that because it sucks the joy out of serving for us. It becomes an obligation, and that gets very weighty. And I loathe that because I want to serve because it is my calling and not an obligation to do so. So the Lord dropped a job in my lap literally a month ago. Not looking, but really desiring, and out of the blue, this happened on a whim. And I can tell you the story individually. But I am now working in downtown Eureka for the City of Advertising and Publishing Commission. Yes. So, very, very excited about that role, and my boss is a sold-out believer and has a positive vision and mission for this city, and I can totally get on board with that. So very, very grateful for that provision. In the meantime, Paul's old boss called him up and said, would you be interested in coming back? Well, yeah, he said. And so we are waiting for that job to just be checked off and approved by the higher ups, and he will be able to have that opportunity. So, be praying for that provision. We are moving. We are looking to relocate. Our house has sold, and we need to move and be out by May 15th. And so, housing is not as plentiful in this area. And so, we are really needing some leads, some financial provision, the job to come through. So we would very much covet your prayers in that situation. what they did this morning. I believe in the miracle power. And it is going to take a miracle. I don't feel deserving of a miracle. But we need a miracle. So thank you, church. Thank you very much. I am honored to be connected to a faith body that will give us this freedom to heal and have the space to do so as a family. And I do want to say, I am so proud of you teens. And you know what? Stand up.
You know, even Danny seeing himself as God sees him.
Yes.
That's a deal, right? So, thank you. And we need you. Those of you that are not here, you're watching online, come back. We need you. Okay? We need you. We need you to give. We do. Because God's got so much more planned for the rest of the year. And it's going to shake off. I mean, we're walking through some more stuff, right? Nothing stays the same. So God is always moving. The Holy Spirit's doing stuff. We need to be nimble and move with Him. And sometimes it's hard. Most of the times it is. Why? Because He doesn't do what we expect Him to do. Can I get an amen? Right? If He did, then most of us probably wouldn't even be here in Eureka Springs. But He does things outside of our box to show us, hey, I can be trusted. So we're going to trust Him. We need you to trust Him with us. And the elders, man, I so appreciate Mike Seals, Quinn Arnold, and Michelle Beaver, and Christy helping us in our planning. It's been such a relief for me personally to go, man, yeah, I can trust these guys. Why? Because they listen to the Spirit. And again, it's not about making decisions that we like. It's making decisions that are obedient to the Holy Spirit, because He's trying to prepare us for that next season. And most of the time when we're going through stuff we don't like, it's for us to be equipped for that next season. And then we look back and go, man, I'm glad I went through that, right? We didn't like it, but it made us stronger. And we would not have made it in the future season without going through the rough season. So, come. I know trust is a huge word, but we need you guys to trust the Lord in us to keep moving forward. Because we're listening, we're submitted to Him, we're being obedient, and we just need you. We want you to come on. We love you so much. Bless you guys.
Praise God. I'm very excited for what the Lord's doing in Paul and Danielle. We cherish our friendship with you. Love you guys so much. I'm excited for today. So when we started the sabbatical, one of the things that we were very, very excited about and looking forward to was that we would draw from the body of believers for people to teach, preach, minister. And so, yes, we were blessed by Danny, Caitlin, and today we have a wonderful surprise. Can you come on up, Caleb Harris? I am so proud of this young man. It has been such a joy and a pleasure to watch you grow in the things of the Spirit. In honor, I count you a dear friend. And I'm proud of you, pressing in, hearing the voice of God, and stepping out in faith. And so I just bless you today as you release the word of God to us. Yeah, it really is. It's a
it's a blessing to be here. And because I've been in places where they don't steward Holy Spirit well, or worship isn't as free as it can be, and this is a place where it's free. Well, when praying about what to speak about today, the Lord pressed on my heart to talk about something that He's actually had on my heart for a little while. And I want to share a quote to start things off to kind of frame what the tone of today is going to be like. I don't know if y'all have read anything by A.W. Tozer before. Mm-hmm. Show of hands. Anyone? Okay. All right. We got a few. Yes. Okay. This is from the book Knowledge of the Holy, which is amazing. I love it. Okay. The greatest question before the church is always God Himself. And the most pretentious fact, most important fact, about any man is not what he at a given time may say or do, but what he in his heart conceives God to be like. What we think of when God comes to mind is the most important thing about you. According to A.W. Tozer, without doubt, the mightiest thought the mind can entertain is the thought of God. And the weightiest word in any language is its word for God. This is the reverence He deserves in our hearts and minds. It is as necessary as drinking water or getting sleep that we think rightly about God. It is our job as true disciples of Jesus and children of our Father in heaven to be dedicated to thinking about Him correctly. Because any view of God that we adopt that does not line up with the Word is to create a completely different God made in your image. And that is not tolerable, and it cannot be excusable in any of our lives. In the Word, this is called the fear of the Lord. More specifically, having a correct view of God results in the fear of the Lord. Like gravity makes things fall, the fear of the Lord comes from thinking of Him rightly. So that's what the title of today's sermon is, the fear of the Lord. So what is it? It is not to be afraid of the Lord. Because God wants intimacy with us. How can we have intimacy with someone that we're afraid of? There's a small difference. But to understand it, we gotta take a look. Let's take a look back at Moses, leading the children of Israel out of Egypt. The first destination after escaping Egypt was not the promised land. It was to worship God in the wilderness. Moses wanted to bring them to the place he first encountered the Lord, Mount Sinai. You good? Cool. When they first got there, one of the first things he told Moses is in Exodus 19:10. The Lord said to Moses, "Go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their garments and be ready for the third day. For on the third day, the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people." Then later, in Exodus 20:18, we see the response of Israel to this. "Now when all the people saw the thunder and the flashes of lightning and the sound of the trumpet and the mountain smoking, the people were afraid and trembled, and they stood far off and said to Moses, 'You speak to us, and we will listen, but do not let God speak to me. Do not let God speak to us, or we will die.' Moses said to the people, 'Do not fear, for God has come to test you, that the fear of Him may be in you, that you may not sin.'" It's interesting because he differentiates. Don't be afraid of Him, but fear Him. It almost sounds like he's talking out of both sides of his mouth, but it doesn't. Those who are afraid of God have something to hide. Those who fear Him withhold nothing from Him. So let's look at that last part of the Bible. "So that the fear of Him may be before you, that you may not sin." That's point number one. The fear of the Lord motivates a turning from sin. Jeremiah 2:19, for those of y'all taking notes, your hands are about to start hurting. Jeremiah 2:19, "Your own wickedness will correct correct you. Your backslidings will rebuke you. Know therefore and see that it is an evil and bitter thing to have forsaken the Lord your God, and the fear of me is not in you, says the Lord God of hosts. Proverbs 8:13, all who fear the Lord will hate evil. Therefore I hate pride and arrogance, corruption and perverse speech. 2 Corinthians 7:1, therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. If we tolerate sin in our lives, we are not walking in the fear of the Lord. If you don't hate sin in your life, you're not walking in who God has called you to be. You might be asking, are you saying that righteousness is based on our works, Caleb? No, I'm not. Because it was Jesus, through his death, burial, and resurrection, who made it possible for us to come to the Father. He destroyed sin's power to separate us from him. So what are you saying, Caleb? I'm saying this. The repentant heart that stumbles, but is still sprinting towards the Father, is made pure, clean, and blameless in the eyes of the Lord because of the cross.
Hallelujah.
But worship that knowingly allows sin to coexist with their faith in the Lord, that is lukewarm and repulsive to the God of heaven. You cannot walk in the fear of the Lord and choose sin. So let's keep moving. Ecclesiastes 12:13. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Ecclesiastes is one of those books that's really dissecting the toughest questions of life. Everyone dies, time marches on, and random things happen all the time. Good things happen to bad things happen to good people. And he's searching these things out. But this is what his final conclusion is about everything. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is man's all. In the ESV translation, it says, for this is the whole duty of man, to fear God and obey him. Nothing else is as crucial as those two. So what does obedience to the Lord look like? Because that's one of the key components of the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord is exemplified by obedience. So what does that look like? Those who walk in the fear of the Lord obey the Lord promptly. They don't just obey him, but they obey him promptly. Psalm 119:60, I will hurry without delay to obey your commands. Number two, they obey him even when it doesn't make sense. When it challenges your understanding of how the Lord works, that's when it's a challenge, but that's what he's calling obedience to. When you hear his voice telling you to do something that is challenging your intellect, your understanding of the situation, that's not when you lean on your own understanding, that's when you lean on his. Yep. Next, they obey him even when they do not see a benefit. Okay, so you may understand the situation and see, well, this doesn't give a heck. I get nothing out of this. I get nothing out of obeying you. Obey anyway. Because that's what you agreed to when you said yes to Jesus. That's what Jesus agreed to when he decided to be born in a manger, was to obey him even when it didn't benefit him. Next, they obey him even when it hurts. So not only is there no benefit, but it in fact is hurtful. It hurts to obey. This last one is really important. They obey him to completion. Let's use this example. So in 1 Samuel 15, Saul is told by the Lord to attack the Amalekites. Not just to attack them, but to destroy them. He's told to kill the king, kill the people, kill all the livestock, get rid of everything. And so he does die, except he kept the king, he kept King Agag, he kept him alive. And he also set aside some of the best sheep and goats and whatnot. You know, sacrifices. You know? He had 99.99% of what the Lord wanted him to do. But what did the Lord say about it? He told Samuel to go to Saul and tell him that you have rebelled against the Lord. But he attacked the city. He killed everyone. They said that, well, God, he killed everyone. You have rebelled against the Lord. Because he did not obey him to completion. Partial obedience is just as disobedient as no obedience at all. So let's look at Abraham's story. Abraham exemplifies every one of these so well. Abraham waited for years upon years for a child, then after years of waiting, they finally had Isaac. Then, the Lord told him to go sacrifice him. Go kill the son that you've waited years for. He didn't tell him. God didn't tell him that he'd be sending his own son 2,000 years later. He didn't tell him that he'd be sending a ram up the other side of the mountain. He didn't say any of that. There was no clarification whatsoever. Go up the mountain and sacrifice your son. What was Abraham's response? Yes, Lord. Did it hurt? Yes. Probably more than if some of you were asked to kill your child. But what did he do? He got up early the next morning. He didn't wait a week. He didn't sleep in. He got up early the next morning, headed up the mountain. And right as he was about to let the knife fall, the angel of the Lord stopped him. Abraham obeyed the Lord promptly, when it didn't make sense, when there was no promise of any benefit, when it hurt, and to completion. Abraham walked in the fear of the Lord. So let's continue unpacking this. Proverbs 22:4. Humility is the fear of the Lord. We heard earlier that he hates pride. He hates arrogance. Sweet, it's complimented right here because humility is the fear of the Lord. Psalm 111:10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praise endures forever. It's the beginning of wisdom and understanding. If you feel like you know how the world works, but it's not based on the fear of the Lord, you're not as wise as you think. Psalm 33:18. Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him, on those who hope in his steadfast love. But you want to feel seen by the Lord? If you feel like the Lord is overlooking you, he doesn't. Two, walk in the fear of the Lord. He sees you. You will feel seen, received by your Father. Revelation 10:6-7. Then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and springs of water. Shouting to the Lord, fear God and give him glory. This next one is, wow, Ecclesiastes 3:14. I know that whatever God does, it shall be forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing taken away. God does it so that men should fear before him. Meaning, everything he does, part of the mission that he's trying to accomplish is so that we walk in the fear of the Lord. Everything he does is so we learn to walk in the fear of the Lord. Isaiah 11:2-3. This is when he's talking about Jesus. I love this one. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. The Spirit of wisdom and understanding. The Spirit of counsel and might. The Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And his delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. That's his delight. He delights in the fear of the Lord. Your Savior delights in the fear of the Lord and walking in the fear of the Lord. If we're supposed to become like Jesus, we walk in the fear of the Lord. So why does he delight in it? Look at Psalm 25:14. The secret of the Lord is with those who fear him, and he will show them his covenant. Who here has secrets? They don't all have to be bad. You know, there are good secrets too. Like, every one of us has secrets. Things that we would not shout from a rooftop. Not everyone needs to know. We all have secrets. But do you share those with just acquaintances? You go up and meet someone and then share them your deepest, darkest stuff? No. You share them with trusted friends. Close friends. The Lord is no different. He is intimate, close friends with those who fear him. If you look at another translation of Psalm 25:14, it says, the Lord is a friend to those who fear him. And it has nothing to do with how many hours we spend worshiping him. It doesn't matter how many tithes and offerings we give, because that's not how intimacy with the Lord is captured. Because Israel fell into that trap many times. Let's learn from their example. Frequently, they fell into this trap. And then Isaiah had something to say about it here. In Isaiah 1:11-13, what makes you think I want all your sacrifices, says the Lord? I am sick of your burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fattened cattle. I get no pleasure from the blood of bulls and lambs and goats. When you come to worship me, who asked you to parade through my courts with all your ceremony? Stop bringing me your meaningless gifts. The incense of your offerings disgust me. When they worship without reverence and fear of the Lord, that's his response. They had no fear of God, and because of that, their worship was repulsive to them. Jesus affirms this in Revelation 3:15 when he's talking about, I know and see that you are neither hot nor cold, but you're lukewarm. And in fact, if you're lukewarm, I'm about to vomit you out of my mouth because you lack the fear of the Lord, because that's what makes your worship good. The lack of the fear of the Lord makes your worship repulsive to the Lord. It's ingenuine. He saw straight through Israel's ingenuine worship. Irreverent and unrepentant hearts are as clear as day to him. Without the fear of the Lord, your growth in Jesus is stunted, and any love for him will depend on your agenda and the benefits you receive from following him without fear of the Lord. So, the true fear of the Lord is to venerate him. That word is used intentionally. Venerate means to honor, respect, esteem, value, reverence, to stand in awe of him more than anything or anyone else. Meaning your response would be so much greater if Jesus came walking down the aisle than if Ariana Grande. Or choose any celebrity that you hold in high esteem. And what would you compare that response? Response of them walking into the room? To the Lord's presence. If they get much more of a response than the Lord, that reflects the fact that there is a need for the fear of the Lord in your life. When we gather together as followers of Jesus on Sunday mornings or Sunday nights, Tuesday nights, and Wednesday nights, we ought to have this attitude. Psalm 89:7, God is greatly to be feared in the assembly of the saints, and to be held in reverence by all around him. Be held in reverence by all around him. Ben, if you could go ahead and come up. started. And yeah, Zach, just play whatever the Holy Spirit puts on your heart. So making time for there to be a response to this. Because the fear of the Lord is as crucial for each one of us. Don't think that you can just coast on the presence of the Lord on Sundays. Oh man, because you could walk into so many services. You can walk into so many services where the Lord's presence is there and think, wow, I feel peace. I feel His love. Thank you, Lord. But if that's all, that's not going to last. You can't put your hope in seeing miracles. Oh, we saw this person get healed. We've seen her legs grow out. We've seen hands heal. Scars disappear. Wow. I've seen God restart dead car batteries. I've seen Him open someone's locked car door that when they left their keys inside. But that's not where we hang our hat. Sure, it's amazing every time we see an incredible manifestation of the presence of the Lord. I mean, people have had encounters with angels appearing in services, and the clouds of glory appearing in the rafters and descending. But those experiences will not sustain you if you do not have fear of the Lord. If you want evidence, let's look back at Moses. We see Israel respond with fear and trembling at the presence of God on the mountain. They see His glory descend on the mountain itself. They're watching it. And they tremble with fear. They were afraid of the Lord. Because they were terrified. Moses was humble, but he walked up the mountain. They did not want to go anywhere near. They said, Moses, let God talk to Moses. Then they can then talk to us. Only then don't have God talk to us, because we're terrified that we're going to die. But they can see, while the mountain was still covered in the glory of the Lord, they turn to Aaron and say, we want a golden calf. We want an idol. If you lose your fear of the Lord, you will not appear. Let's take it a step further. Even Satan himself, when he was called Lucifer, was in the presence of Almighty God, beholding Him in all of His glory, His unrestrained glory and holiness bursting forth, burning everything around it. His perfection, His holiness, His goodness, like a star, like a sun, is just everywhere, and Satan is there in His presence, leading worship. But he had no fear of the Lord, so he fell. To honor the Lord should be the heart of every one of us. We don't live this life, we don't do this for what we get out of it. We don't follow Jesus because it's beneficial. He promises benefits, but if that's what it's based on, you're not gonna last. Because when fires come and you're tested by life circumstances, and you're basing your faith on benefits, a shaky foundation. If we could have a few members of the prayer team come up to the front, we're gonna make time for a response here. This is the time. If you've been hearing what I'm saying and realize that there is a need for a filling of what Jesus walks in, the Spirit of the fear of the Lord. If you feel like there is not reverence in the way that you walk your everyday life, not just today, but throughout the entire week, then come up to the front. Come up to the front and just get on your knees and receive what the Lord has for you. If someone's not here to pray over you, there will be eventually. Because this is not to beat down on you. If you're feeling already far from God, this is what you need. Because those who fear Him feel close to Him. We started singing "Jesus, We Love You" earlier, and there was such an intimacy. There was such an intimacy there.
Responding, saying, "Lord, reveal more. Search me, O God, and know my intentions. Search me, oh God, and know my heart. I don't want to just be okay with being blind to the things that I don't know are sin. I want you to reveal sin in me. Reveal the things that I am not doing like Jesus, because I want to be close to you. Above all else, I want you, Lord. Search me, oh God, and know my anxious thoughts. When we have that heart, we are seen as blameless and holy. Because of the cross, my grace is sufficient for you, and my power is made perfect in weakness. But do we use this grace to live in sin? No. We clothe ourselves in the fear of the Lord, and we learn to hate sin like He does. To desire to remove ourselves from the things that hurt His heart, that the things that He hates. So Lord, we just pray. We pray for a baptism in the fear of the Lord over this room. We pray for a filling of your presence. We pray for more, that this house would be a house that stewards your presence well, that walks in the fear of the Lord. Let us be a house that walks in the fear of the Lord, because God forbid we do anything else or walk in any other spirit or think that we can minister to this city impactfully in any other spirit with any other plan. God forbid we walk in anything besides the fear of the Lord. Fill this place. Fill this place, Jesus.
in healing in your body, if you need prayer for anything, it doesn't have to be the fear of the Lord. We'll pray that over you too. But if y'all are needing healing over your body, come forward. We're gonna stay in this place for a little bit. If you have to go, if you have places to be, then okay. Like you are free. You're free to go. There's no judgment. But we're gonna have time. We're gonna make time for a response to this.
I want